I am Brother Stephen Elabo, welcoming you to Deeper Life Bible Church, Charlottesville, United States, a place where the undiluted Word of God is being preached. You are about to listen to our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, as he comes forth to share the mind of God with you and your family. I want you to be ready. Pick up your pen and your paper and jot down important messages as they will do you good. God bless you and remain blessed.
So you can sit down. As we go into the Word of God today, I want to remind you, next Sunday is the last Sunday of this month. And it's going to be a concluding month, and something special is coming your way next Sunday. Of course, today is special. Everybody help me shout, special. But next Sunday will be very wonderful. And those who are to come for their combined service, next Sunday, come here in time, get here in time. You always do. I'm just saying that because it's a new year and something great will touch everybody's life this whole year in Jesus' name. I'm reading from Hebrews chapter 11, and we're looking at verse 13. Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, that they embraced them, and they confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. What a verse to start a message. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the promises. Look at verses 39 and 40. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. It's talking about the Old Testament prophets, Old Testament patriarchs, Old Testament people. And it's like they were looking ahead. They wanted to receive the promises, but their own promises for their own time, for their own generation, for their own dispensation was given to them. But the Lord was choosing a kind of people, the Gentiles, you and I, and he has reserved something great for us. And so when you read in verse 13, they died, they left, they quit, and they passed on from this world without receiving the promise. Here it comes in verse 39, and it says the same thing, and is all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. God having prepared some better thing for us. That better thing is coming. And so, when you look at the people in the Old Testament, and you say, but they trusted God, but they believed in God, but they trusted that he'll give them this and this and that, because that thing was promised, and it was not done. You did not go back to the Old Testament, Old Covenant, Old Dispensation, and say, maybe you, I will not receive, you will receive. Because better things are waiting for the people in the new dispensation. Come back to verse 13. I'm reading the last line there in verse 13. They were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Look at verse 14 now. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned, but now they desire a better country. We're getting there. That is an heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to call them to be called their God. For he has prepared for them a city. It's the latter part of that verse 13 I want you to pay attention on. He confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims, pilgrims and strangers in this earth. And the Lord wants us to understand that we're passing through this world and through this earth, and we're going to the better country, we're going to the heavenly country. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 11. First Peter chapter 2, and we're reading verse 11. It says, "Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims," as strangers and pilgrims. It tells us very clearly and pointedly that we are strangers and pilgrims in this world. Who is a pilgrim? A pilgrim is somebody on a journey. We're coming from the city of destruction. We're coming from Egypt. And we're going through this wilderness of a world. And we're going to the promised land. We're going to the pleasant land. We're going to the holy land. We're going to paradise. We're going to heaven. We're moving on from our past. And we're going through this world. And we're going to the promised land. That means then we're pilgrims. In my father's house, how many mansions? If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again so that I receive you and take you unto myself. It tells us that we're hoping for that day. We're hoping for that city. We're hoping for that better country. And because we're traveling on and we're getting there, I am getting there. I said I am getting there. That's why it says we're pilgrims. And you want to be a wise pilgrim, a wise pilgrim. Who is a wise pilgrim? The person that faces the direction of travel. Here is where I am going. And I face that direction. And you are focused. And you are faithful. And you are fervent in the things of the Lord. And you do not allow the things of this world to tie you down, because you are a wise pilgrim. Who is a foolish pilgrim? A foolish pilgrim is the one that is forgetful. He forgets why he started the journey. He forgot, he's forgotten why he became a Christian. He's forgotten why he came into the kingdom. He's forgotten the promise of eternal life, everlasting life. And he forgets that he has led the perilous land. He has led the city of destruction. And then he's either slowing down, or he's turning back, or he's sitting down, and he's not making progress. We're going to the wise pilgrims in Jesus' name. We're going to talk today on the spiritual profit and progress of wise pilgrims. The spiritual profit and progress of wise pilgrims. Already it has ascertained in the word of God who we are, strangers and pilgrims in this world. We're journeying on, we're traveling on to a better country, to an heavenly country, to the pleasant land, to the holy land, to the land of promise, to paradise, to heaven. And there are 3 points we're going to talk about. Number one, sustained purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. Sustained purity. It's not just an initial deposit of purity and then after that we'll forget purity. It must go on. Because who are the people that will get to the heel of the Lord? Who are the people that will abide and dwell and live in that holy place? They that have clean hands and a pure heart. Sustain purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. You're a pilgrim, you have to be nourished in the word of God. You have to feed on the word of God. You have been strengthened by the strength of the heavenly manna that comes into your life every day and every week and throughout your journey from here to glory. Nourished, baptized. The people who are baptized unto Christ, they're baptized in the Spirit. They're baptized in the fire of the Holy Ghost. And the zeal and the fervency is there. And they know where they're going. And they're focused on the place they're going. Sustain purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. Point number two, solemn paradox and peril of negligent, busy pilgrims. There are pilgrims that get sidetracked. There are pilgrims that they see something on the way and they say, hey, this is interesting. And they're very busy on those things on the way to heaven. They slow down their journey. They're stopped in their journey. They concentrate on non-essentials on the way. Very, very busy, but they're now negligent of the calling God has called them. They're negligent of the journey that they are pursuing. They're negligent of the goal they want to reach. Solemn paradox and peril of negligent, busy pilgrims. Number three, spiritual profit and progress. Somebody there is making progress this year. I am making progress in Jesus' name. Say it for yourself. Spiritual profit and progress of new Bible-believing pilgrims. Bible-believing pilgrims. So coming to number one. Tell me number one there in your notes. Sustained purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. We're looking at that 1 Peter chapter 2 again. 1 Peter chapter 2, and I'm reading here from verse 11. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, it tells us in verse 11, dearly beloved, I beseech you, as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. There's a battle. There are many people that do not know there's a battle because Satan does not want them to get to heaven. Satan wants to stop you on your journey. Satan wants to retard or delay or slow down or totally stop the journey so that you will not get to heaven. And many people do not understand this internal war that is going on and this internal hindrance that is going on and this particular personal war that is going on. Satan is warring against your soul, and you're a pilgrim, you're a stranger, and you neglect all that, and then you're toying with any other sin. It says, how wise will that be? Look at verse 1. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that she may grow thereby, to grow in strength, desire the sincere milk of the word, and to grow in power, desire the sincere milk of the word, and to grow in your focus, in your attention, desire the sincere milk of the word, and to grow in faith, the faith that will make you jump every hurdle and climb every mountain and fly over any hindrance. That faith coming by hearing by the word of God. Desire the sincere milk of the word that will cleanse you, purge you, purify you, and make you ready for the coming of the Lord. Desire the sincere milk of the word. It cleanses us. Whereby shall a man cleanse his way? Young man cleanse his way by taking heed according to your word. And then it says in verse 3, if so be that ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, the grace that saves, the grace that sanctifies, and the grace that strengthens, and the grace that baptizes you in the Holy Ghost, because it's by the grace of God we're saved, by the grace of God we're sanctified, by the grace of God we're filled with the Holy Ghost. That promise is unto you. It is a promise that he gives unto us, and when he fulfills that promise, what grace we receive from the Lord. Look at verse 5. He also has lively stones. Because you are saved, you come alive. Because without coming alive, a dead wood cannot move. A dead man cannot move. If you do not have the life of Christ in you, you're not even a pilgrim yet. But it is when you realize you are dead in sins and trespasses. It is when you realize you are dead in the old man. It's when you realize that death, the deathness of this world has been upon you, and then you say, Lord Jesus, I confess, in myself I am dead. Only in Christ, the risen Savior, do I come alive. I hold on to him. I believe him. I receive his forgiveness. I receive his eternal life. Then you come alive. And it says, ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house. It's building us up. Every service, it builds us up. Every prayer, it builds us up. Every word, it builds us up. At home, you read the word of God, it's building you up. Everything you read that encourages you, enlightens you, edifies you, is building you up. Every message you are hearing as you come to the service, any Sunday and every Sunday, is building us up. Building us up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer all spiritual sacrifices. Only those spiritual sacrifices are acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Look at verse 9 here. In verse 9 it says, but ye are a chosen generation. That is, after you have turned away from sin, you turn to the Savior, and you receive him a definite way. Not that I'll be coming to church. Are you born again? Well, I really don't know. I don't understand. This being born again. Have you at any particular time in your life since you were born into this world, have you at any time come to the Lord to say, this day, and you know the time, and you know the date, and you know the moment, this time I come to you, my Savior. I know that I am a sinner, and that I cannot save myself. I have heard the good news, the gospel, that you, Christ, you died for me, in particular, on the cross of Calvary. At this time, a moment of time, this day, a particular day, in this place, a day you can remember, a place you can remember, this day, I surrender my life to Christ. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your eternal life. Lord Jesus, I believe that your promise will not fail. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I am saved. And the Spirit of God will be a witness in your heart. A change has come. There will be that joy of salvation. You remember the time. You remember the day. If you don't have any time like that to remember, you need to go to the Lord today. If you don't have any day like that to remember, you go to the Lord today, because you might be turning over a new leaf, changing little by little by little, and copying the children of God, and talking like they talk, and reading like they read, and walking like they walk, and putting your hand where they put their hand, and you think that converts you, that there's no salvation there. But that moment of time, and then the Spirit of God is saying, now you are a child of God. Not only that, there'll be another evidence. If any man be in Christ, it's a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. You were fighting before, the urge to fight is no more there. You were having conflict before, the urge to have conflict is no more there. You had bitterness and hatred before, the desire to fight with anybody, have any conflict with anybody, is no more there. You were a Jezebel before, a temptress before. You want to make a man fall. The urge to do that is no more there. You're thinking of heaven, and you're thinking of glory, and you're thinking of when Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, will come. There is a change on the inside you. The Spirit of God, it brings peace in your heart. All the harassment of the devil, all the restlessness within you, everything is gone. It's a change of direction. Now you're thinking of heaven. You're thinking of when he will come, I will go with him. And as things that other people can see, your dressing will change. Nobody has to, you know, sit you down and say, don't wear this, don't wear. You will just know. The Spirit of God will say, now you're a child of God. All things have become new. That's what he's saying. And now he says, you're a chosen generation. He has chosen you. Because you have chosen Christ to be your Savior and to be your Lord, he too, he has chosen you. Look at that, a royal priesthood. You are now a priest unto the Lord. And it is not just ordinary priests, it's a royal priesthood and holy nation, a peculiar people, that he should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That's the thing that takes place. And once that has taken place, we say, praise the Lord, a new life has come. Praise the Lord, I come alive in Christ. Now you are a pilgrim. Look at verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also has left you, has suffered for us, leaving us an example that